Hey, good morning, folks.
Good morning.
Great to see y'all. Thanks for being here this morning. Thanks for joining us, those of you here and those of you joining us online. Thank you. Won't you worship with us? Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, look near. Come behold His power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the One who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice! Sing the mercies of your King and with trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood, and bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice! Sing your mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. And all our sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. And turning tragedy to triumph, and turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice! When you cry to Him, He hears your voice, and He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice! In the midst of suffering, He will help you sing. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice! Sing of mercies of your King, and with
set me free. I'm happy to
to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. 'Cause I could sing of your love forever.
I can sing of your love forever.
I can sing of your love. Happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. 'Cause I can sing of your love forever.
I can sing of your love forever.
I can sing of your love. I know, but when the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now.
I can sing of your love forever.
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 Keep finding voices in my mind say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again of who I am, 'cause I need to know.
Sure.
Lord Jesus, we believe. Father, whatever we're going through, whatever you say we are, that's who we are in your eyes. Father, we're redeemed. We're your saved children. We love you. And for those of us who have a hard time knowing what to believe, give us the courage that in your good name, we are righteous. We are holy, and we are pure. Lord Jesus, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to Mountain Life Church. My name is David Zuperkew. I'm your executive pastor. If you are new this morning, welcome. Thank you for coming. We are a church that loves Jesus. We love people, and we love our community. And we hope that you'll experience that if you stick around and get to know us a little better. If you haven't done so already, and you're new, go through those doors at the end, go to the Welcome Center, and you can meet Laura and their team, and they'll tell you more about our church, and can tell you how you can get plugged in, and we got a great gift for you. I want to tell you about Starting Point today. That is at right after, so the slide is up here, right after the second service. If you haven't done this before, if you're newer to the church, or you just haven't got an update in a while, come on through the back door, right in room 101. We're going to have a luncheon, and we're going to talk about our church, how you can become more plugged in, and then we find out a little bit more about you, and we do this over a great meal. So we hope you can join us for that as well. Coming up, we have a blood drive, and we are partnering with the American Red Cross May 9th through from 1 to 6. We hope you will sign up and donate blood. This is a way for us as a church to really be outward focused and show our community in a tangible way that we can help them, that we love those who are in need. And we're told right now that the blood is at an all-time low in this region. So if you're able to do that, let's fill up the slots and let's do that. So you could sign up online or go back to the Welcome Center, and there's time slots, and we'd love for you to partner with us and the Red Cross. All right, I need to give you a fun update. Ukraine, let's talk about Ukraine. Our church is partnered with two ministries that are active in Ukraine right now, delivering food, supplies, getting refugees out, and we heard last week from Annie that Max is there, they need medicine. And so we were able to get some medicine in Poland and in Romania and able to bring it in. So I told you that we needed about $25,000 more to do that. And so up to this time, you, the congregation, have raised $100,000. Isn't that amazing? So that's amazing. So I told you last week that they needed about another $25,000 to house people and buy these big medical shipments to bring them in. Remember I told you that there are no shelves, there's no supplies in the stores. Remember our stores with COVID and there was nothing there? Well, there, this is war. There's no replenishment. Drug stores are empty, grocery stores are empty, everything's empty. So anything that comes in is delivered in with different ministries, different organizations, and of course our team. So I told you we needed $25,000. I guess you guys must be talking because we raised $25,153. What? Isn't that crazy? That is absolutely amazing. I was just like, wait, Okay, recount the money. Is that for sure? Did that really happen? That's what happened. So up to date, you, our congregation, have raised for the people of Ukraine $125,000. Praise Jesus, right? Isn't that awesome? All right, it's my privilege to lead us in prayer this morning. Would you bow your heads and hearts to the Lord? Father God, we are amazed at what your people are doing in Ukraine. Father, thank you for enabling us to partner with two organizations that are able to be in there right now, Father, delivering food and supplies and medicine and taking people out of dangerous areas. Father, would you be with those teams? Give them safety. God, help us get that money to the right source. God, help us procure the stuff that we need and get it to the right lines, to the right people. Father, more important than all of that, would you enable our Christian team to witness to the people who are struggling, to share Jesus with people who need it more than ever? Lord God, this is a broken world we live in, right? You've redeemed us. We're your children. Thank you for using us to show your love to these people who are in need. God, thank you for this church. Bless the people here who are giving and want to be part of that. And then, Father, help us remember and pray for the people who are there. This is a long, tough time. Father, I want to be holding up the team. Our crisis response team is right now on the way to Lake Charles, Louisiana. Father, hurricanes devastated that area. And our team is going there to help rebuild. It's been almost 2 years. Father, give them the courage, the strength to have spiritual conversations as they rebuild, as they help to make things new for this community that's just torn up. Father, thank you for the team of nine that have taken time from their jobs, taken vacation time to go serve you and to represent our church in this community. Be with them, Jesus. Lord, for everything we have in our hearts and our minds, God, we give them to you right now. Help us to pause, reflect on your goodness. And Father, as Pastor Dave comes from K2 Church and opens up God's word, Father, help our hearts and minds to hear that dying to self is really alive to something new. Be with him now. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, everyone. We have Pastor Dave Nelson.
Hi.
From K2. Thank you for coming.
You bet.
He's going to open God's word.
Thank you. Well, man, that's an awesome celebration, you guys. Way to go. That's super cool. And I'm not surprised. We've actually been the benefit of your support as well. We started a ministry down in the valley called Loving Utah. And I moved out here 19 years ago with my wife and 30 people from Detroit, Michigan, to plant our church. And I just know church planting is really hard. So we started a ministry called Loving Utah to support every church planter that comes in this state. And you guys have been a financial supporter of that. And I want to tell you, when I moved here to plant, like, I had to seek out people, right? There was not a whole lot of church planting going on. Now, when we hold a summit, we'll have 100 people show up. God's doing some great stuff. So I just want to say thank you for that. And Scott's been a great friend to me, too, just supporting me and reaching out to me as another pastor. And so I'm grateful to be here with you guys this morning. And I just want to remind you, because I have to remind myself, even sometimes when I pray or when I'm opening up the Word in the morning or when I attend a service, right? This is just something we can get into just, hey, this is what we do. We go to church, we read the Bible, we pray. Do you guys know that God's here? Like, sometimes I just think we need to stop and go, wait a second, I'm not just going to go to church. God says, I inhabit your prayers, and he's here. That's crazy. The one who created all of that and everything beyond, who's so beautiful and so glorious and more powerful than we could ever imagine, says, you meet in my name, I'm with you. So, man, don't forget that as we dive in. And as I share his word to you today, he says, my word is alive. It's actually active. He goes, it'll penetrate. It'll go right to the deepest core of who you are, every one of you today. And I love, he calls it a double-edged sword, which means when it comes in, it divides. And I know this is going to happen this morning. What's going to happen is his word's going to come, And then you're going to, all of us, I usually find myself going, really, as I'm talking. No, but he will come, and all of a sudden you'll go, wow, here's what I thought, and here's what God says. That's what the word does. It helps us to get to what reality is. So I'm thrilled to be able to share this with you. Like I said, I'm from Michigan, and I actually love roller coasters. Really? Thank you. All right, I have a fan. More fans. Anybody else want to cheer me on? In the back. Thank you very much. All right. But how many of you love roller coasters in here? How many of you love roller coasters? All right, good number of you. How many of you hate roller coasters? Okay, all right. It really is about, I would say 60-40 usually. A few more love them. I grew up hating them. I have a fear of heights, but when my family, when I was 8, went to Disneyland, and my older brother and sister made me ride Space Mountain. It was horrific. But eventually I grew out of that and got to the point where I love roller coasters too. But here's what I realized. Being from Detroit, Sandusky, Ohio has the, oh, we got a nod already going. We have, Sandusky, Ohio is the home of Cedar Point. And Cedar Point has the best roller coasters. In fact, if somebody else builds one that's faster and higher than theirs, then the next year they're like, oh yeah, and then they build another one. And so a great place. And I have a buddy, actually, it's so funny, whenever Cedar Point would do a new roller coaster, he would go there the day before and camp out to be the first one. So he literally, they'd punch his ticket and he would race to the place so he was could say, I was the first one to ride that roller coaster. I love that. And I found when you watch people ride roller coasters, there's two type of people, you haters and you lovers. If you're a hater, you're standing in the line and you're letting people go, oh, go ahead, right? Just anybody else want to go before me, please? And you let them go before you. And then when it's finally your turn and you have that row of roller coasters, where do you sit? Which seat do you sit in? In the middle, exactly. You're in the middle. And if you're old school like me, remember they actually had the seat belt? And you tighten that puppy up so it's as tight as it can be. The bar comes down and you clench it. And you've got, and you're shaking. And then you go up that horrible hill, click, 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 click. And it goes over the edge and you're just like, ah! And you just, you hate every minute of it. And then you have those of you who love roller coasters. And you're like my friend, and you're racing toward, and when you finally get in, where do you sit? In the front or the back, because you're already going fast before it even is over the hill. And then, if you had the seatbelt, what did you do with it? You make it as loose as possible. So when you go over those short hills, you fly right out of your seat. So fun. And you're going up that click, 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 and your hands are up in the air. You're looking at the poor people in the middle going, come on! Put your hands up in the air. You go over the hill and it's pure exhilaration and joy. I feel like that's what I see in the church. I see some people who are like, and then I see some people who are like, woo! This is awesome. And then let's be honest, most of us are like, okay, right? I'm in, but not like all the way. And this is who we are. And I just want to tell you, my desire for you today is that maybe some of you would loosen your grip a little bit. Some of you would loosen your grip a little bit and realize that Jesus, the creator of this, the Savior, the one we just sang about, came so we could live life like this, man. This is the life he has for us. My favorite verse for years, still love it, John 10:10. Jesus says, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. And let's face it, man, in this world, there's a lot of that going on. There's not one of us in this room who will ever escape having things stolen from us, having losing things, destructive things. Sometimes our own soul feels that way. But Jesus said, I came so that you would have life and life to the full. And I want to tell you, this was one of the biggest surprises to me when I gave my life to Jesus. Because I thought giving my life to Jesus would mean I'd have to be weird. I was really scared of that born-again term. And I thought you'd have to wear, you know, like really bad clothes and listen to really awful music. And he's like, no, that's all that religious stuff. And then when I gave my life to Jesus, I realized, no, I want to take who I made you to be and make you come alive. And then when I went into ministry, right out of college, and I didn't know what I was doing, I majored in education because I wanted to teach high school and coach football. And then God's like, no, I got something else for you. So I go into this to ministry, and even when I went to my Christian college, I just remember I had found Christ, and it was so amazing to me. But then I got in Christian communities, I'm like, especially my college, I was like, do you guys know the same Jesus I know? Because it doesn't look like it. And too often, the church and followers of Jesus, we're like, I don't know, like when Jesus was going, oh, I want you to be like this, and I want to encourage you, you can do this. So in John 10:27, Jesus says, my sheep listen to my voice, I know them, and they follow me. So Jesus is speaking. He's going to speak today. I'm going to speak. But here's the craziest thing. Every time you get together and somebody speaks his word, thoughts are going to come to you. You're going to be sitting there thinking about what I'm saying. All of a sudden, thoughts are going to come. That's how the Spirit speaks. So Jesus says, I'm speaking. We listen. That's what you're going to do. But then we follow him. And then he says, and I know them. That word know, in the Greek, there's two different words for know. We only have one, so it's really confusing to us. So when he says, I know them, when we think know, we usually think intellectual knowledge. Like, I know something. I read about it, and I know it. But Jesus says, no. No, I know you. This is my wife, Susie. She's sitting over here. That's like, I know her. I don't read books about her, right? Well, let me learn something about my wife today. No, I know her intimately, experientially. And Jesus is saying, if you hear my voice and you follow me, you and I, you're going to know me. In fact, Jesus said, can I tell you what eternal life is? He says, eternal life is that they would know the one true God and Jesus whom he sent. And again, that's not knowing about him. My guess is some of you know some stuff about him. Do you know him? Do you experience him? That's life. And it isn't, you don't have to wait till heaven. That's the coolest thing. You can know him now. And Jesus said, and I came so you could have eternal life. So you could experience me and know me. So then in Luke 9:23, he says, whoever wants to be, so if you want that, do you want this life? He goes, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. So there's a principle to the full life in the kingdom of God that Jesus wants to help us understand. And I'm going to use an illustration here to try to help us grasp this. So bear with me one sec. I'll be right with you. All right, here we go. All right, so you guys just play along with me for a little bit. I'll use my education degree here. I have two seeds, right? Okay, if I set one seed on the stool right here, and I take the other seed, and I dig a hole in this pot of dirt, and I bury the seed, which one has a chance to grow? Now, here's what I love about this illustration. I have used this so many times. Every time, everybody laughs. You know why you laugh? Why do you laugh? Because it's so obvious. It's just obvious. You know this one has no shot, and this one does. Okay, you ready? Jesus says in John 12:23, Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, Now, this is the NIV, New International Version. If you actually go to the original language, and NASB and ESB will use this, it'll say truly, truly. Truly, truly. But this is fascinating. You know what the word truly is? It's the word amen. Jesus says, amen, amen. Well, what does that mean? I'm like, wait, we say amen at the end of our prayers. You know what amen is? When God says amen, it means it is and it shall be so. So whenever Jesus says truly, truly, that means major emphasis here. He's saying, I'm telling you reality. It is and it shall be so. It is and it shall be so. Now, when we say amen, I don't know if you guys knew this, then you're saying, so let it be. So God comes and says, I'm telling you reality. And then in response, we go, okay, bring it. Let it be. Here's what he says. It is, and it shall be so. I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Now surely, this is John 12, he's right near the end. So surely Jesus is talking and he's preparing for his death. He's letting everybody know, when I die, this death of mine is actually going to produce, look at this, right? How many thousands of years now the kingdom of God has advanced and the church has grown. That's what Jesus was saying. I'm going to die, but it's going to produce many seeds. But he also says, this is a principle in the kingdom of God, and it's true for you, and it's true for me. Because look at what he says next in verse 25. Anyone. Now, if he says anyone, who's that mean? Yeah, anyone. That's what it means in the Greek even. It's just anyone. That means you. Come on, man. Don't buy any lie, anything that you're thinking inside your head that this doesn't include you. Anyone who loves their life will lose it. It is, and it shall be so. While anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever, again, Jesus just making sure y'all get this. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. You guys, here's the principle in the kingdom of God, and Jesus point blank, God came down here to tell you this. It is, and it shall be so. You die to live. You die to live. And this is super hard for us, man, because you laughed at this because you know this doesn't have a chance. But Jesus is saying, but if you try to save your life, if you try to run your life, if you stay in control of your life, and you will never die to yourself, that's what you got. But if you will die to yourself and surrender yourself to me, you guys think about this, man. What's inside this thing? What's inside here? There's a freaking tree in here. There's a tree in here. And not only that, this tree is going to produce fruit that has a bunch of seeds in it that are going to fall to the ground and they're going to die, and then that's going to produce what? An orchard. There's an orchard inside of here. There is an orchard inside of you. Every one of you. And the enemy is trying to steal it away, kill it, and destroy it. He is so scared of you. He is so scared of you. If you ever, if you ever actually die to yourself and give your life to Jesus, look out, world. look out darkness. You will be rescued from it and put in the kingdom of light. And you will produce many seeds. Man, bring it. That's what I say. All right, so Matthew 16:25. No, let's just go here. I'm just going to jump in now. So I'm just going to give you a few illustrations. This is fun because I don't know you guys. So I'm going to give you a few stories from my own life, and I think I probably should hit every one of you as I go through this. I grew up in a church going home, okay? So went to the United Methodist Church in my town, but Jesus was never a topic of conversation in our home, okay? So it wasn't like I was growing up in a Christian home, but I was going, my parents were good people, and they told us to go to church. Thankfully, I went to a church that actually did preach the good news about faith in Jesus. And so one day, I was 11 years old, and I'm sitting in our pew, and I'm in the middle. I have four brothers and sisters, and it was a concert at the end of in the evening. And this guy gave a call to give your life to Jesus Christ. Any other good old Methodists out there? Okay, a few of you. So when you get a call, when the guy gives an invitation, what do you have to do? You have to go down to the altar call, right? So you got to get up in front of everybody and come down here. And I'll never forget, I'm 11 years old. I don't know anything. My mom and dad haven't taught me anything. And it's the weirdest thing, man. God was just saying, I want you. I want you. I love you. Come on, David. And I'm sitting there and I'm like going, there ain't no way, man. So I made a deal with God. You guys ever make deals with God? And I told him, I said, hey, if one of my friends goes, I'll go. So I'm standing there, and I'm literally looking around just going, come on, somebody go. And then finally, Jim Poit started coming down the aisle. Jim wasn't even one of my friends, but he was my age, and that was enough. And I'll never forget, man, I had to go, excuse me, Mom, excuse me, Dad, Mark, Diane, Amy, Mike, like, what am I doing? And I went down to that altar, got on my knees, and I'll never forget, man, all I prayed was, God, please help me stop crying. I was so embarrassed. But when I was 11 years old, what did I do? Go ahead, what did I do? I did, but in light of the message, what did I do? I died. I died. I did surrender. I gave Jesus my life when I was 11 years old. And you know what's fantastic? I have never been the same since. I love it when I see an 11-year-old kid. I'm like, are you kidding me? At that age, you can be changed. And God's Spirit can come inside of you. And I just want to tell you right now, if you're sitting here today and you don't know this, if you don't know the freedom of having all of your sin forgiven forever, if you don't have fullness of joy, because Jesus said, I came so my joy could be in you and your joy could be complete. If you're not at peace, when he says, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives, man, come on, what's the world do? Well, if things are going great, then, oh, and then the world tanks and we're all like, but Jesus is going, oh, by the way, you know why you can do this? Because there is a belt that's holding you secure inside your car. And that's what God wants to offer you. If you don't know eternal life, if you have never found your life, and today, anytime, I don't care how long you've been in church, I don't care what you've ever heard, here's all I know, and it's such a mystery to me. I don't know, God, I don't know. I go, why don't you just do this every day? But I do know this. When it's time, you'll feel Jesus saying, I love you, and I want you. And you have a chance to no longer laugh at this life, but live this one. And he will come into your life, fill you with his Spirit, and set you free. So, I was changed, and I really loved him. But I needed more, right? I'm growing up, and my mom and dad didn't know how to help me. And so in my youth group in church was parents who tried to do good stuff, like don't have sex and don't drink. That was really helpful. And I never had anybody let me know Jesus. So I was in a long-term relationship, 4.5 years with a girl. Loved her. I had accepted Jesus, but my girlfriend trumped him like major. And it wasn't a good relationship. It wasn't healthy, but man, she was everything to me. But she didn't want to have anything to do with God, and I did, and it was this weird tension. So one day, I'm 19 years old now. I'm in college, and now I'm not following him. The sex and drinking help didn't help, and I'm living in ways he doesn't want me to live. And I'm out mowing the lawns for the city park. Great summer job, you know. I'm on my lawnmower, and I'm out in the middle of nowhere, and all of a sudden, God just came back to me. It's the weirdest thing. Nobody was saying anything to me, but God came back to me, and he basically simply said, David, you know this isn't the life I have for you. You know this isn't the life I have for you. And I got done with work, and I was driving home. It was summer. My window was down. And you know how when the cars go by, when your window's down, they make that sound like, shoo, 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 shoo. And I just kind of got transfixed by, shoo, shoo. And I'm looking out the window, shoo, shoo, and something inside says, you should look at the cars. And I'm like, shoo, shoo. And then finally I turned, and right in front of me, a car had stopped. And I tell you, I can't wait to go watch this, and I'm hoping we get to kind of watch what happened with our life. I don't know how I missed that car, but somehow I did, and I'm like, oh my gosh. And all I did was say, 10 minutes home, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Because I can tell you this, man, if anything would have happened to me on that day, I wouldn't have really been ready to go see him. And he kept bugging me, and he said, I just knew it. I knew I needed to end this relationship with the thing that was most important to me, who that I loved more than him. I'll never forget, man. I was, you know, so I'm a jerk, teenage boy. Like, if there's any of you in here, please listen to this and don't do this. You know, I'm just kind of letting her down little by little, right? Just separating little bit and confusing her. And then she calls and says, hey, would you come over? And I'm like, oh, I'll let her down a little bit more. And finally, I was looking in the mirror, and I just felt like God said, no, you're going to tell her today. So I did. And I drove over there. It was horrible. Tears, weeping. Some great God you've got, Dave. You're the one good thing in my life, and now he's taking you out of it. I'm like, yeah. But I ended that. And I remember I drove home and I just screamed at him. I yelled at God the whole way, you better take care of her. I was so mad. And then I woke up the next morning and I was free. It was the weirdest thing. I even physically felt lighter. What did I do? Say it back to me. What did I do? I know this, man. I know this. I don't know you, but I know humanity. And many of you in this room have received Jesus. You're his follower, but you're not following him. You love things more than him. And that's where your real devotion lies. And if you're really stuck in sin, he just says, listen, I can't fellowship with that. I just can't. You're not losing me, but I can't fellowship with you. 1 John 1 says that. Light, what fellowship can light have with darkness? So if you're walking in darkness and you're going, but where's God? Where's this? If you've lost your freedom and your joy and your power, then I know right now the Holy Spirit already has told you. You know what it is. And you know, you got to kill it. The scripture actually says, put to death whatever belongs to your sinful nature. And here's the beautiful thing. If you actually are a follower of Jesus, you know this. If you finally will and repent and turn to him, what's he going to do? He's going to come running to you, man, and he's just going to embrace you because he's already forgiven you. He just now wants you to be free. And I hope someday, some of you today will die and be free. Last one. I surrendered everything. I did it. I went to a Christian college, gave him everything. Everything. Everything a 19-year-old kid could do. I'm like, God, I just gave you my life. And that's when I said, let's go for it. And I can honestly say, since 19 to 57 now, it's been a great ride. Not that I don't do this sometimes, COVID was kind of wacky. Even right now for us as a church, it's a very hard season. So I might be doing this now, but I'm sure working to do this. But while I was at Asbury College in Wilmore, Kentucky, I wanted God to use me. Any of you feel that way? Or any of you like, man, God, I want you to do something with my life. And so I was kind of complaining. And I remember it was an eight-hour drive to school, and all I did was look out the window, to God. How come you aren't doing good, great things with my life? And then we had a missions conference, and a missionary came from Colombia. And I was in college in the 80s. Colombia was a communist-infested country. Remember the communists in the 80s? That was really scary. And so they came to our room, and he shared the story. He said he was in the depths of the jungle of Colombia learning the language for a tribe so he could transcribe the scriptures to him. And he said one day the natives came running through the jungle, and they said, they're coming. And he said, so he grabbed his wife and his two little kids, and they just started booking it through the jungle. And all of a sudden they heard these motors, and sure enough, man, they hid behind these big, huge plants, and there were two flatbed boats coming down the river with communist soldiers with semi-automatic weapons, for the sole purpose of getting them. And he said, it was so weird. He goes, we sat behind this plant, and he goes, I just realized. He goes, if we live or if we die, it's all in the hands of God. And he was totally at peace. And I sat there, and I go, yeah, you are weird. He got done with that great story. We had curfew. I snuck out, and I went to this golf course, and I was walking out, and I'm going to God, God, why aren't you doing great things with my life? Why aren't you great doing things with my life? And I want to tell you, this is one of the most profound moments I've ever had with him. He just stopped me, and I felt like each one of my feet weighed like 10,000 pounds. I could not move. And I felt like God led me through a thought process. He said, you know what? There's a group of people in the depths of Colombia who don't know me. I'm going to create David Michael Nelson. He's going to be the son of Kenneth Eugene Nelson and Edith Joanne Nelson. He's going to grow up in Lapeer, Michigan. He's going to go to Trinity United Methodist Church. And one day he's going to go to this concert in the evening, and I'm going to call him to be my son. And I'm going to fill him with my spirit so I can send him into the jungles so these people will know me. And I'm sitting there, and I'm standing there going, oh my gosh. And I just feel like God said to me, David, will you go to the jungles of Colombia me? Now, it's kind of hard when you're just you and God go, oh, sure, God, I'll go. When you know you won't. See, I knew I wouldn't go. And then I felt like God said something very clear to me. See, David, you want to do great things for me, but I don't have you. I don't have you. I was like this. And I remember, man, when he took me through that journey, and I just sat there and I thought, man, if that's why I'm here, if the reason, do you guys know that there's a reason you're here? The only reason you're on this planet is because God thought of you. And he says, and when I thought of you, I ordained days for you. He's the only one who knows why you're here. And I stood there and I go, if that's why you created me, then I gotta go. And I knew in that moment that I would go. And I said, I would have hopped on a plane the next day. And it was amazing, man. My feet were light and I was free. What did I do on that day? Say it back. What did I do? I died. You know what was crazy? I tried to go on every mission trip that the school offered and I could never go. And I realized God didn't want me to go to Colombia. He just wanted to know if he had me. Are you mine? Have you lost your life, really? See, he didn't want me to go to Columbia. He wanted me to go to Salt Lake. Way worse. Hey, true follower of Jesus sitting in this room. True follower of Jesus. Are you doing this? Or are you doing? There may be something you need to die to. It might not be sin. You know, throw off everything that hinders and the sin that entangles so you can run the race that God's marked out for you. There might be just something he's asking you to do. and you've been hesitant and you're scared. Hey, I tell you the truth. Truly, truly, it is and it shall be so. If you will stop being this and give your life to Jesus today for the first time, from sin or just in reckless faith, you will find your life. And he will produce many times more than what you could ever do on your own. 30, 60, 100 times. And then when your journey's over and you get to be with him finally, you won't look back and go, oh, what was I doing? You guys know that? This scares the crud out of me. Then I'm going to get up there and go look back at my life and go, what was I doing? Why did I get caught up in all this stuff that doesn't matter? Let's go to heaven and see him face to face and have 30, 60, 100 times of fruit. All right? So let me pray for you. Father, thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, thank you for telling us what's true. Thanks for revealing reality to us, that we were created for you, for fellowship with you, intimacy with you. That's eternal life. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving us of all of our sinful rejection of you. All of it. Thank you. And then thank you for making our heart your home, for filling us with your spirit. God, here's what I know. You love every person in this room. And you created them to become an orchard of fruit. So Lord, if you're speaking like you spoke to me, to anyone in here today, I pray now for your grace to strengthen them to make that move. I wasn't going to do this, but I am. I'm just going to do it because I get to leave after today. So if you are a follower of Jesus, but you've got one hand on the bar and one up and you're going, no more. If you're sensing today, like I did on that golf course, I give you all of me. Would you go ahead and stand real quick? Because I want to pray for you. If any one of you are in this room are feeling that. Just tell them, man, this is Jesus. Sweet. God bless this group with fullness of your spirit, fruitfulness far beyond anything they've ever dreamed. You who can do more than you could ask or imagine. God bless them greatly in Jesus' name to take whatever step you're asking them to take. And stay standing. And if any of you are that second crowd, you're a Christian, but you know there's just something you got to let go of. There's something that's been in your life, and you're just going, this has hindered me, and I don't want it to hinder me anymore. And you know God has told you, get rid of this thing, let it go. Go ahead and stand with this group that's already standing, if that's you today. Awesome. Fantastic. Oh, freedom's a sweet thing, you guys. Lord, for that group right now, I pray for grace and mercy to let it go. As they walk out these doors, may you give them the power you gave me to be able to let go of the thing I loved more than you. And God, then fill them with your peace and with your joy and your freedom that they can run again. Oh, God, that they can run again in Jesus' name. And then I'm going to ask if any of you in here have never actually just given your life to Christ. You just never have. But today you want to do it for the first time. You actually want to put your seed in the dirt and receive Christ, receive his life and his forgiveness. If there's anybody in here, if you want to stand right now, I just want to pray for you if you would like to receive Jesus Christ for the first time today. All right. Well, Lord, I just think even if someone didn't stand, woo us, woo all of us, God, to die so that we can live. We receive you and your joy, your peace, and your life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor.
Church, there's nothing better to do right now than to remember Jesus through our Lord's table. Who's the Lord's table for? It's for us who are saved, for us who call him our Savior. He's redeemed us. And so as you get ready to come forward, we're going to do something slightly different today. I want you to come forward, take the elements, and go back to your seat and reflect on what Jesus has done for you. Purify your hearts if you have sin in your hearts. And then we'll all take communion together. So if you all will stand during the song, would you come down through the angle aisles, get the elements, return in the center aisle, go back to your seat, and let's do business with Jesus.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's here, where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Only lead me to the cross. You were as I tempted and tried. Human, Word became flesh for my sin and death. Now you're risen, everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Exchange is so dear for despised by the world as a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it on dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling
Church, Matthew 26:26 says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, and he said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for the many forgiveness of sin. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit until the day I do it with my Father in this kingdom.'" Father, the friends, the origin of the seed that we heard about today is here. He's in our lives. And we have this chance to remember him. Take the bread. Broken for us was Jesus, because he loves you and redeemed you. Take it. His blood shed for you, shed for I, for redemption, because we are made new in likeness in him. Until we see him again, let's drink to our Lord. Lord, we